GriefShare is a support group ministry that helps people heal from the pain of grief. The GriefShare video seminars, workbook exercises, and small group discussions give participants encouragement, useful advice, and hope.
The GriefShare videos are excellent.
The video strengthened me.
It's a freeing kind of thing to be able to talk about your loss.
My workbook helped me to unravel the feelings I was going through.
If you know people in your church or community who are grieving the death of a loved one, tell them about GriefShare. Or visit a GriefShare group yourself to heal from the pain of your grief.
There was such a void until I got into GriefShare.
I never really healed down deep until I came to GriefShare.
GriefShare brought me out of my sadness.
Begin your journey from mourning to joy at GriefShare.
Join us for our next Explore class. I'm excited to meet all of you who want to learn more about our church and ask questions about possible membership or baptism. Lunch will be served and childcare is available with a reservation. If you plan to join us, make sure to RSVP at dbc.org/explore.
Welcome to DBC. Whether you are online or in the room, we're so glad you chose to worship with us this morning. DBC is a place where you will find God, and we are a church with a strong community. Our connections are strong because our people join groups and serve others with their own unique gifts and talents. As a church community, we worship God through singing, praying, serving, and giving. At DBC, you can give online or by dropping an envelope in the offering boxes in the lobby. To find out more about giving, visit dbc.org/giving. If you're new, we want to get to know you better, help you find your group, and let you know what's happening at DBC. Please fill out a connection card by scanning the QR code in front of you or visiting dbc.org/connect. We'd love to meet you after the service, so please make your way over to the connection corner where you will receive your free gift and be able to ask any questions you may have. Now, check out these opportunities where you can join DBC in our priorities to love God, love people, make disciples, and make a difference.
Hey, Jeff Reams here, missions pastor for DBC.
And my name is Jonathan Goode. I'm the executive director of Orchard, a Dunwoody Baptist Church mission partner.
We want to invite the entire DBC family to join us on September 11th from 5 to 7 p.m. to help us give away $100,000 to six well-deserving ministries during the pitch.
You do not want to miss this event. The pitch will be a fun, inspiring, high energy event celebrating the excellent work of six ministries that Dunwoody Baptist Church and Orchard have chosen and prepared to make their pitch.
This is going to be an amazing night to celebrate the generosity of God toward our church. Each ministry will receive at least $10,000 and the top grant is $50,000. So register today at dbc.org/thepitch. This event is free and there is childcare or a movie night available for your kids. We hope to see you at the pitch.
Thank you. Hey, fellas. Nice grills.
Praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that I got. Come on, there's nothing that I got. Can't do. Oh, there's nothing that I got. Church, this song that we just sang and the song we're about to sing both proclaim how powerful our God is. And He is not a God that leaves us alone, but He is there with us in the midst of our battles. Sing this out as you know it's true.
When all I see is the battle, you see my victory.
In the battles, but He has overcome the cross, He has overcome the grave, and He is seated at the right hand of the Father. Amen. He is a God that overcomes, and I want you to sing these words out because we know that they are true.
Now the darkness fades into new beginnings.
as we lift our eyes to a home beyond. All creation waits with an expectation to declare the reign of the Lord our God. Come on, church, check this out. We will not be moved when the earth gives way. Silence breaks in the name of Jesus as the heavens cry, let the earth respond. All creation shouts with a voice of triumph to declare the reign of the Lord our God. We will not be moved when the earth gives away. For the risen one is overcome. And for every fear, there's an empty grave. For the risen one is overcome. Church, this is when we sing, He shall reign forever and ever for all of eternity. It is a beautiful message to a God who is worthy. He shall reign forever, strongholds now surrender, for the Lord our God has overcome. Sing this out. Who can be against us? Jesus our defender. He is Lord and He has overcome. He shall reign forever, strongholds now surrender, for gives way, for the risen one is overcome. And for every fear, there's an empty grave. For the risen one is overcome. Yeah, we will not be moved when the earth gives way. Amen, church. Amen. It is a beautiful thing to know the goodness of our God. And these songs are so simple, but they are so true. And I want you to sing this out with us.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Come on, all my life, you say,
with all my life you have been faithful. In all my life you have been so,
so good.
With every breath that I am able,
oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led.
fire in the darkest night. Come on. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. Oh, I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. Come on, church, let's declare this this morning. All my life. With all my life, you have been faithful. With all my life, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
My name is John Hume, discipleship pastor here at Dunwoody Baptist Church, and it's our joy just to welcome you to our service today, to let you know of just some of the opportunities we have. I get to lead when the Explore class, a class that just helps us understand more of what it means to be a member here at Dunwoody Baptist Church. And then today we're leading the Discover Your Purpose class, a class that is designed that you can see how you're uniquely shaped to serve in areas that God has called you to serve. As we look at replicate, as we look at what it means to be a disciple today, I pray that you are understanding those things and you're ready to step out and follow Him in every way possible. Would you pray with me? Father, we love you and we thank you for this morning. I thank you for the faithfulness of your people here for so many years of just leading, being a light in this community, continuing to give, continuing to serve, so that others can know the beautiful, life-changing message, God, that we find in your Son, Jesus. I pray that you speak loud and clear through our pastor today and help nothing get in the way of us clearly hearing from you and what you want us to do today. We love you. We praise you. And Jesus, we ask it all in your mighty and great name. Amen.
Well, good morning, church. That was lame. Good morning, church. I like that better. We are in a series called Replicate. And in this series, we are trying to say, as we visit our vision and purpose statements, like we do every year at this time, we're trying to look at it through a little bit different lens. We always talk about why we're here at Dunwoody Baptist Church. And if you are new to us today, I walk around before the service and I meet several of you who have been here 3, 4, 5 times, 6 times, first time. And our Explore class that John talked about just a minute ago, that's kind of the gateway or the pathway class to let you know what we're about and to let us hear your story. And October the 2nd will be the next one of those. They're immediately after this service. We provide lunch for you. We want to get to know you and help you know kind of the journey that we're all on. The Discover Your Purpose Lab is today, and that's the, as John said, that's a chance for you to discover where you might fit in. We need volunteers. I mean, there's so much stuff going on around here, from the parking lot to the nursery to the student ministry to all kinds of places, that we need you to say yes if that's something that the Lord's put on your heart. And we've got several ambitious initiatives that are starting up really, really soon, and we would love to have you join us in that. But what this month is about is to kind of visit our mission statement once again. For you who are new, what we stand for here at Dunwoody Baptist Church is that we are passionately becoming more like Jesus. That's our measuring stick. That's our standard. Are we becoming more like Jesus? And are we interested, invested, convicted, committed to transformation that our homes, our church, our community, and our world are impacted because we have chosen to be followers of Christ? And we think that we do that because we are learning as a community of faith to love God, love people, make disciples, and make a difference. Well, every August we visit that, and this August we're visiting it with a little bit of a twist, and that's why we call it Replicate. We want to love God, but we want others to learn how to love God too. We want to love people, and we want to teach others how to love people. We want to make disciples, and then we want those disciples to make disciples. We want to make a difference, and we want to share that value, expand that footprint, so that others join us in what it means to make a difference. You saw the bumper video with the laser, the 3D printer, and each week we've made a different figurine based on maybe a little sculpture or a little something that we have around the office. The first week we did a little girl praying to talk about love God, and last week we did a little figurine of Jesus washing Peter's feet to talk about loving people. Well, today I wanted to show you the original that we copied. This is a little sculpture we got in the office, and I really love it because it is a grandfather teaching his grandson how to fish. And you know the old saying, right? You give somebody a fish, they eat for a day. You teach them to fish, they eat for a lifetime. And so it made the making disciples piece kind of fall into place for me. Because to make disciples is to pass on the things that I've learned in the faith to someone else with the expectation that they will pass them on to somebody else. That's sort of what we're about. And each week we've given our little figurine away to somebody who sort of exemplified that in our church. And so today our 3D copy of this, well, where's Bill Norman? Bill, I know you ran a half marathon yesterday, but can you get your legs up and make your way up here? If he's limping a little bit, that's why. Bill has so exemplified what it is to make disciples in our young adult class. And Bill, I appreciate that more than you can know. I know this won't be in your treasured possessions, but it's just a way to say thank you. We make disciples. And so today I want to talk about that, and I want to give you a quote. I'm quoting myself, which seems very egotistical, but I wrote this in a book called Disciple, that disciple making is not complete until the disciple becomes the disciple maker. Discipleship is not complete until the disciple becomes the disciple maker. Until this process is communicated, the old cliche is that Christianity is always one generation away from extinction. And so what we want to talk about today is how we pass that on to the next generation. So today we're going to be looking at Matthew chapter 28 and 2 Timothy chapter 2. And if you've got a paper Bible, turn to it. If you've got a swipey thing, turn to it. There are some Bibles in the chairs in front of you. This is where I want to go. By the grace of God and the sustaining power of His Spirit, He has protected the church in every generation. When things were darkest, when things were going on in the world that it made absolutely no sense that Christianity would survive, either because of bad behavior on the part of Christians or because there was persecution outside the church, there's a lot of times in our history that it makes no sense that Christianity survived, and yet it did. Our mission is to pass on the lifestyle, the discipline, the conviction, the commitment that come with discipleship to the next generation. And today, what I'd love to do is just to describe that process, to describe just a little bit what it means to be a disciple. But first, a couple of definitions. To make disciples is to secure the handoff so that another can continue the race. In the history of the Olympic Games and the World Championship track events, the American relay teams have done one of three things. They have finished first, they have finished second, or they've been disqualified. Hadn't finished third, fourth, fifth, sixth, one, two, or not at all. And except for two times in that whole duration, the disqualification has been because they couldn't pass the baton from one runner to the next. Now, let that soak in. Since 1988, the Americans have been disqualified from the relay, the 4x100 relay, in the top events in the world, the Olympics and the World Championships, 13 times, all because they dropped the baton. Now, I am very cautious, being a non-athlete. When I tore up my knee, the doctor said, there's no hurry to get it fixed because you're not an athlete. I go, you had to go there? But it would seem to me they would have baton class. They would figure this out, figure out the exchange. They have to hand it off successfully within the distance allotted, the exchange zone. If they don't do that, get this part, the race for them is over. There have been times where the anchor leg of the relay never got run because the baton didn't make it that far. At whatever point the baton is dropped, the race is over. And I kind of want to let that image soak in. Now let me drop a few definitions. What is a disciple? Well, the word is both a verb and a noun. Kind of like barbecue. You can barbecue or you can eat barbecue. Well, you can be a disciple or you can disciple someone else. To be a disciple is to be a follower of Christ. That's simple. And to be a follower of Christ, it means that at some point in your life, you have realized that you have done things, thought things, been things, participated in things that don't honor God. The Bible calls that sin. And in Romans it says that we all sin and fall short of what God would have us to be. And then the Bible says that if we continue in that sin, the consequence for that is that we are eternally separated from God. The Bible calls it death. The wages of sin, the payment for sin is death. The free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. Well, what does that mean? In Romans 5:8, the scripture says that God demonstrated his love for us. He loved us so much that he sent his only son to be that sacrifice so that our sin wouldn't have to separate us from God. How do we make that exchange? How do we take the baton? Romans 10:9-10 says, if we confess with our mouth, if we agree that this is a plan that's best, if we agree that I need to become a follower of Christ, if we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, we'll be saved. That's the word the Bible uses to talk about someone who's become a follower of Christ. They are saved from eternal damnation. They are saved from the wrath of God that is aimed at sin. And that's the starting point for being a disciple. And I say that because a lot of times we in church life try to paint it another way. Well, we're trying to help you be the best version of yourself. We're trying to shape our culture. We're trying to help this world to be a better place. We're interested in justice. We're interested in helping you as a parent. We're interested in helping you in your finances. All of that is true. But the starting point for being a Christian, the starting point for being a disciple, the starting point for being a follower of Christ is to say, God, I need you in my life, and I can't fix me. So that's kind of the starting point. And at the end of the service, I hope that you will sort of do a mental evaluation. And if you haven't ever come to that place where you said, God, I want to offload my sins on you. I need to be a follower of Christ, and I know I can't fix me. We have people out in the lobby that are wearing name tags, that are wearing green shirts. We have pastors all over the place. You've met most of them, Brian, Alan, Jeff, John, Bridget. They are here to help you start that conversation where you can be a follower of Christ. Because to be a follower of Christ is disciple. That's a noun. But to disciple someone is to participate in the process where someone else might become a follower of Christ. So in your Bibles or your phone or tablet or wherever you are, there's a passage of scripture in Matthew chapter 28, beginning in verse 16. I've just got a part of that up here, but beginning in verse 16 and all the way through verse 20, it's the last words that Jesus spoke while he was on earth. And as we go, we make disciples, we baptize disciples, and we instruct disciples. Here's the scripture. The verse that we're going to look at says, all authority has been given unto me in heaven and earth, and go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all I've commanded you, and behold, I'm with you always to the end of the age. Now let me break that down just a little bit. If you look all the way back at verse 16, the context is there. Jesus had been crucified. He had been buried on the third day, that Sunday morning, that Easter Sunday morning. He rose from the dead. But in Acts chapter 1, Luke tells us that after that, after the resurrection, he hung around for a little over a month, 40 days, and he taught some more and fellowshiped some more and encouraged some more. And it wasn't like he was with them all the time. It's like he would show up and disappear. He would show up and disappear. But in the context of all of that, he said, guys, I need you to go back to Galilee from Jerusalem. Galilee is a little north. It's around the Sea of Galilee or the Lake of Galilee. And I need you just to wait for me at the mountain. Now, apparently, they knew where he was talking about. Maybe it was the same place he preached the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, 7, I don't know. But they knew where he was talking about, so they went there to wait. Verse 16, now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had directed them, and when they saw him, they worshiped. I love the honesty of the Bible. You see the next line? But some doubted. I'm going, really? He used to be dead and now he's not, and you're still doubting? And I get all self-righteous and go, well, if I'd have walked around with him for 3 years, I wouldn't have any doubts. But then God says, oh yeah, you would. You're human. And so there's almost built into this whole passage a description of what a disciple noun is. Look at what it says. The 11 disciples went to Galilee as they were told. So a disciple is obedient. A disciple does what they understand is what God wants them to do. A disciple worships. When they saw him, they worshiped. Natural reaction. I see a resurrected Jesus, I'm going to worship. So there was a natural response. But then it says some doubt it. A disciple's honest. We don't try to pretend or hopefully we don't justify what people say about us as hypocrites. We're honest. The word that's used there for doubt, it doesn't necessarily mean cynicism. It's more like hesitancy. It's more like I'm still trying to get my mind around this. It sort of makes us think of doubting Thomas, one of the disciples who told Jesus, I'll believe when I see the wounds from the crucifixion. That's when I'll believe. I love that Matthew included that. Because when we are disciples, there is an honesty about saying, I don't understand everything about God's plan. I don't understand how all of the, I don't even understand everything the Bible says, but I want to. I'm trying. It's not that I'm cynical. It's just that I'm hesitant. My mind is blown. I'm trying to wrap my mind around it. Then he says, and Jesus came and said to them, all authority. If you look down at your Bible or your swipey thing, you can circle the word all 4 times. Verse 18, all authority. Verse 19, all nations. Verse 20, all that I've commanded you. Verse 20, I'm with you always. There's an all-encompassing aspect of what's going on here about discipleship. A disciple is surrendered. He says, all authority on earth has been given to me. And if Jesus has all the authority, Alan doesn't have any of it. All is sort of a measuring stick. All over here means none over here. And let's say 3/4 of the authority has been given to me, and Alan, you get 1/4 of it. He says all authority. That means I surrender to his authority. Do I understand it all the time? No. Do I want to all the time? Really, no. But it's his, all authority. A disciple is surrendered. I like this part. Go, therefore, and make disciples. Do we have any grammar police in here? Anybody who basically understands the English language? The grammar there is obviously an imperative. Go, therefore, and make disciples. But if you were to break down the language, the word go there is not the strong imperative in the sentence. The word go is more of an assumption, a transitive. As you are going, and then the strong imperative in the verse, make disciples. So the make disciples is the strong part, and as I read it really closely, it occurred to me that it would never cross the mind of Jesus that he would have to tell us to go. That wouldn't be part of his arithmetic. Oh, and I'm going to have to beg you to go and tell people about this good news. So as you go, make disciples. There's the verb, disciple people, make disciples. So a disciple is obedient to that mission, surrendered to that mission. But then he says, baptizing them. Well, why do we baptize? What is baptism? We got a baptistry right over here. And in the Baptist church, we let you be all the way underwater when you were baptized, complete immersion. And that's sort of a picture, but back in the day when he talked about baptizing them, he meant a public identification. So is baptism necessary for you to repent of your sins and be saved? No, it's not. But he says when you're baptized, there is sort of a public identification. It's like putting on the jersey for your favorite team. I'm not ashamed to be identified as a supporter, as a fan of Team Jesus. I'm all in. And so baptism is a public statement. It's a public way. And so Jesus said, as you go, make disciples. And when you make a disciple, when somebody understands that they need to repent of their sins and begin to follow Jesus, baptize them. Let them be publicly identified with the community of faith. So a disciple is identified. And then a disciple is teachable. Make disciples, baptizing them, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. And then he gives a promise. A disciple's teachable. But all that's kind of scary to me. I'm obedient, I'm identified, I'm surrendered, I'm honest. I'm out here, and Jesus says, I'm out there with you. You know, it's would be almost never that a president of the United States would be on the front lines of battle. I think the last one we know about was Eisenhower. Normally, they're way back from the battle. And in 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel chapter 11 in verse 1, the prequel to the famous sin of David with Bathsheba, it says, it was in the spring of the year when the kings go to war, but David was in the palace. David was a king. It was spring. Why wasn't he at war? Why wasn't he out there in the battlefield? Well, what Jesus says right here is that he is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. He is the creator of the universe, the savior of the world, and he is on the front lines with us. When we go, he goes. I am with you always, even to the ends of the age. So Jesus kind of gives us the why of discipleship. He helps us understand the noun part. A disciple is obedient. A disciple is honest. A disciple surrenders. A disciple is identified. A disciple is teachable. A disciple is confident in the presence of Jesus. But the Apostle Paul was a lot more of a pragmatist. He showed us in real terms what that looks like. Because we have stories. So in the Old Testament, we've got lots of stories. Moses and Joshua and Elijah and Elisha and Samuel and Eli. And we've got those examples where an older generation passed the baton of faith to another generation. But in the New Testament, we've got it very plain. Of course, Jesus with his disciples. But Paul, a little later, he sort of helped us understand it even better. And in 2 Timothy 2:2, we call that generational discipleship. Went to Dallas this weekend and spent some time with my son and my grandson. And this is a picture of us at the cafeteria at the Dallas Zoo. It's hot in Texas this time of year, and so we went into a extremely overpriced restaurant to take advantage of their air conditioning and eat some chicken nuggets. And I took this picture because as I looked at my son and my grandson across the table, there was an overwhelming sense of responsibility that I am called to speak into their lives. That I am the grandfather, that is the son, that is the grandson. And while others will speak into them spiritually, while churches and pastors and youth pastors and VBS directors will speak into their lives, God gave me sort of an overwhelming sense of it is my job as a generational grandfather to speak into their lives. Well, Paul understood that in terms of spiritual terms, and he had lots of guys that followed him. And Paul's statement was always, you imitate me as I imitate Christ. You don't do what I do unless it's what Jesus did. So I'm going to imitate Jesus. You imitate me. That's what I want to say to my son and grandson. Try to ignore all the bad things I do, all the mistakes that I make, and imitate me when I'm imitating Jesus. That's what disciple, the verb, means. And so in 2 Timothy 2 and verse 2, he says, and what you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. And if you're paying attention, there are four generations of disciples there. There's a great grandfather, a son, and a grandson. Paul, Timothy, faithful men, and others. And we see in there the expectation that there is generational discipleship. Discipleship doesn't happen unless the disciple becomes the disciple maker. And so it's our job to pass on the convictions and the surrender and the obedience and the identification, all those things we saw in that last passage. It's our job to make sure that the generations that follow us understand that. Paul goes on from here to say, just in case you didn't get it, let me give you three illustrations of what this looks like. And he talks about a soldier, he talks about a athlete, and he talks about a farmer in the verses that follow too. He says a soldier never gets entangled in the things of the world, and the word entangled there is like a sheep getting caught in the briars by its wool. He says that when you get caught up in things that don't matter, you're immobilized in terms of your effectiveness. He said an athlete always finishes the race by playing by the rules. Maybe he had in his mind passing the baton. You don't play by the rules, you don't get to finish the race. You don't get to finish the race, you never get the prize. An athlete finishes the race because he plays by the rules. And he says a farmer gets the first of the crop. And that feels a little selfish to me. But I start thinking about it, a soldier knows immediately whether the battle has been won. An athlete knows immediately if the game has been won. But a farmer is the one who demonstrates perseverance. Plants the seed, waters the seed, talks to the seed, prays for sunlight. But there's absolutely nothing he can do to make that seed grow. And yet the disciple who plants the seed in a disciple, hopefully to plant the seed in another disciple, there's a sense of patience and waiting and understanding that God has to provide everything that seed needs to come out of the ground. And so the farmer is the first to see it. Why? Because he's been expectantly watching it. So disciple, noun, obedient, surrendered, teachable, identifying, all of that, honest, worshipful. A disciple, verb, pours into another generation all the things that Paul has said to Timothy. He says, you just tell these to them who can teach others. I'm not looking for really, really beautiful men or really, really skilled men. I'm looking for faithful men who can then teach others also. This week, John Hume brought me a blog. And the blog is describing an experience that the writer of this blog had in an Apple store. And so this is what the blogger wrote. He said, not long ago I was in the Apple store because my iPhone didn't work. A young lady was helping me. She probably was 20. When she was working on my phone, I started talking to her about her job. I asked, "Have you been working here long?" She said, "Not really, just a few months." "You like working here?" I said. Her face lit up. "Oh, yes." Seeing her enthusiasm, I decided to inquire further. "Well, I bet it's hard learning all this stuff." He was probably my age. And it is. Said, "How did you learn this?" She said, "Well, I just went online. There were some job openings. I registered, 2-day seminar at a local hotel. After 2 days, they placed me in a store and assigned me to a mentor. For the first few weeks, I just wore regular clothes. And the mentor wore the bright Apple shirt and lanyard. And I just watched everything he did and took it all in. After dealing with a customer, he would ask me if I had any questions or we would discuss that particular situation. By this time, she had stopped working on my phone and was completely into the story, so I just listened. Then she said, after a while, I put on the Apple shirt and the lanyard, and my mentor dressed in regular clothes. And he followed me around as I took care of the customers. If I had a problem, he was ready to jump in and help. And when he thought I was ready, he just set me free to go out on my own. Now I'm prepared to do the same things with another trainee." The author made the connection. This is the preacher who was observing. He said, "What she described was disciple-making, Jesus style. Jesus took in curious men, drew them to faith, let them shadow him for a season. Then he cut them loose to go out on their own. When they were ready, he watched them reproduce into 72 more men. His plan was so simple and yet so profound. Jesus drew men to himself, let them follow him until they got it, and then he sent them out to reproduce." Now I wish the author had stopped there to let me draw my own conclusions, but he continued to beat me up. Says, "When I look at the modern church, I'm grieved that somehow along the way we've missed it. We've missed the strategy of Jesus. Somehow we've traded making disciples for making decisions. Somehow we traded a clear process with running programs. We stopped moving people through stages of maturity and started shuffling people between services and churches. Somehow along the way, we thought that if we got people into worship and in a group, that they would figure it out all along by themselves, become strong, when in fact the church has become weak. We've forgotten that the church exists to train up men and women who will take the gospel to their offices and neighborhoods in the world, and we just started trying to fill seats. What Jesus gave us was simple, reproducible, and powerful. Apple gets it. Do we? Disciple making, discipleship is not complete until the disciple becomes the disciple maker. Would you pray with me? God, we are grateful for the way that you love us, for the clear plan that you've given us. And it is my prayer, Father, that in every single person who's in this room, that you put in their mind three faces of people that you wish for them to disciple. That they are looking for faithful men who can teach others also. But my prayer is that for the disciples in the room, you would place in their mind three people that this week they would begin to challenge them just to have conversations. God, for persons in this room who have never committed their life to you, who have never said, "I want to be a disciple of Jesus," I pray that this will be the day they start that conversation by going to a green-shirted or name-tagged person in the lobby, by finding one of us pastors and saying, "I want to begin the conversation to repent of my sins and to embrace Jesus as my Savior." Let this be the day. Let this be the day when this church begins to practice discipleship Jesus style. And this is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Church, it is so much easier to go and advance the gospel whenever we realize that that is a response to seeing what God has done in our lives. So as we close the service, go ahead and stand, and we're going to worship one more time.
See, on the hill of Calvary, my Savior bled for me. My Jesus set me free. And look at the wounds that give me life, grace flowing from His side. No greater sacrifice. What He's done, what He's done. All the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. I praise God for what He's done.
Sing for the freedom He has won. Even death is dead and done. His life is overcome. Speak. Say the name above all names, over every broken place. He is risen from the grave. What He's done, what He's done. All the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. My future is hell.
Father's will complete as He reigns in victory. So sing hallelujah to the King. He is worthy to receive all the worship we can bring. What He's done, oh, what He's done. All the glory. Forgiven. My future is heaven. Oh, I praise God for what He's done. And what He's done. Oh, what He's done. Yeah. All the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. Your future is heaven. Oh, I praise God for what He's done. And I praise God for what He's done.
Jesus. Church, it is so simple.
This is Gary McIntyre, and it has been my privilege to serve you as online pastor this morning. Thanks again for worshiping with us from wherever you happen to be. Again, if you have any questions about what you've experienced today or about how you can engage in the activities of DBC, you can reach me by email at any time during the week at onlinepastor@dbc.org. I'm also available if you need prayer or if you desire information on how to become more involved with our church community. For those of you watching on our website or app, you can have a live private chat with me by clicking on the prayer request button for the next 10 minutes. Have a great week. We look forward to you joining us again next week, either in person or online.